the observed rates that we measure in some particular laboratory reactor. Okay, so let's just take a look at an example of a reaction kinetic model. So we kind of worked our way from the big problem of, say, business to down to reactors. Now we're looking more on a local basis on like reaction kinetic models. This example is a reaction kinetic model for fission probe synthesis, which is based on a fairly complicated multi-step microkinetic type of model. Here you can see what the rates of reaction are for the various species. In this case, the rate of net rate of formation of the paraffins and olefins shown here. Here the value of N can vary anywhere from 2 to 20 in this case. So you would have roughly 41 or so reactions if you 20 from olefins, 20 from paraffins, and the water gas shift reaction. So basically this set of equations describes a detailed formation of the paraffins and olefins starting from their respective feeds. Now, if we know a reaction kinetic model, our goal then is to, moving forward, is to incorporate that in some type of particle model to describe what are the transport effects which can occur on the particle scale. And this shows some recent work we did looking at different particle shapes for the Fischer-Tropsch synthesis, in which we looked at diffusion reaction in these different shapes, described by the usual equations that you see here. We actually did this in 1D, but we also later extended it to 3D, so we did account for, in fact, and effects. And here we show what is the transport parameter effective diffusivity, and some previous work by Wang showed how does diffusivities vary for CO, for hydrogen, and CO2, and then also how they vary as you go to the higher molecular weight components. So knowing the reaction kinetics then, and one can solve these equations, and then you can then describe what is the behavior and on a local basis within these various types of particles. And I won't go into this in any great detail, but this just shows, for example, how the concentration profiles for diesel, the C13 to C17 range, how that varies in like different shapes. So this is work done by one of my students, shown here. And we basically looked in great detail at what is the impact of particle shape on the performance. You really can't assess it until you put these into an appropriate model for a reactor. And you can show then that there is a shape that can in fact improve the performance over the conventional solid shapes or shallow spheres which are of course commonly used. Okay, another interesting example that we'll talk a little bit later in the talk is basically commercial sulfuric acid catalyst. This shows different shapes of which are available, ranging from the smaller type, so-called type 210, which are like basically solid cylinders, okay, up to these 10 millimeter rings, up to the what I call boulders, these 20 millimeter rings, okay. And then we have, of course, the daisy shapes. Now, what's happened in this technology over the years, the shape has evolved. It's evolved for several reasons. It's evolved because, number one, they want to obtain particles that have, of course, a higher activity, which means that you'll have a reduced SO2 emissions. But they also want to reduce particles that result in a reduced pressure drop. Turns out those are two counter-opposing things. We know smaller particles in general will give us a higher pressure drop, but also like improved activity. So the game has been to try to figure out how do you add these lobes and other types of artifacts on top of regular shapes in order to increase activity while, of course, minimizing the pressure drop. Now, pressure drop is very important because these plants are large, and of course, you're moving around a lot of gas. If you're producing 1,000 metric tons of acid a day, it's very important to try to minimize the pressure drop because that, of course, impacts energy. Now, again, we could use that same approach that I showed earlier, and we could examine the detailed performance of these various particle shapes. So in the past, a lot of work went toward trying to identify optimal shapes, but by the use of modeling tools, one could try to start examining what is the impact of shape, not only on pressure drop, but also on on the effectiveness factor or the activity of the catalyst for a given microkinetic type of model. This just shows some examples from some of our recent work where we looked at different types of particle shapes, shown here the so-called rounded step or the so-called light bulb type of catalyst, and one can start to understand what is the connection between the details of the geometry of these particles, and how does one start to introduce some science and some technology into the particle forming process. The other important factor here, too, also that one has to consider is the fact that one has to worry, of course, about dusting and also the mechanical strength of the catalyst. So you could say, well, I'm going to put bigger holes here. That's going to improve my diffusion and loads. Well, it turns out that there's only so much you can do because when these are loaded into reactors and people are walking around on top of the particles with their boots on and rakes, and you produce fines that can reduce the dusting, it results in significant pressure drop and premature shutdown of the plant. So it's very important to not only understand how these catalysts perform from a reaction diffusion point of view, but also the next thing we're taking a look at is how does mechanical strength impacted by these different shapes. And that, of course, gets into the science of like materials and has a kind of a mechanical engineering type of element to it. Now, we could take one of these particles and we could put it in like a flow field. And you could then start to examine, well, how does it behave? What is the role of the fluid mechanical behavior on the catalytic performance? So this is just a single particle that's in like a flow field. But this just illustrates, of course, the behavior of the particle. And of course, how you can see that really the behavior of the concentration and the temperature field is, of course, it's not a symmetric type of behavior that we typically use when we solve diffusion and reaction problems. So this is really the reason why when one goes to ensembles of particles and how they may be sitting, even in like a laboratory reactor, that's very important to understand how is the fluid mechanical behavior in the reactor impacting how that particle is performing. All right, now what I want to do is to step back a little bit from that and just do a little review. What are the main types of laboratory reactors that are used in practical types of applications? In general, they can be broadly divided as shown here. We, of course, have integral reactors where we have a significant change in the concentration. We try to aim for a plug flow behavior. And, of course, it's possible in this case to have a significant change in concentration from the bulk to the surface. And also in the actual particle itself, which we just saw in those examples, which I just illustrated. Now, if you operate the reactor at a lower level of like conversion, in the say 5 to 10% range, then we still can have these significant intraparticle effects, but maybe the intraparticle effects are smaller in that case because the conversion is low. Now, the other approach, of course, is to recycle this recycle the product gas, and now of course we have so-called recycle reactor, commonly referred to as the loop reactor. Now, in this case, it's possible to have large like gradients, but by having high enough gas velocities, one can minimize the intraparticle gradients and still have intraparticle gradients present. Well, and finally, we can have the classical stirred tank reactor, which we work with commercial particles. We can still have gradients in that particular device. So these are the primary targets that you're trying to achieve in some type of laboratory reactor when you're evaluating heterogeneous reaction kinetics. Now, if you go back, you can find some, over the years, there's been much has been written about these different types of reactors. And that's why when you go into the R&D labs of both companies, you'll find a wide variety of like reactors in like many cases which are used. Although today there's been a drive toward trying to have some standards in certain types of R&D labs. So this just shows some of the different types of reactor configurations. And this was actually written in the late 1970s, but many of these reactor configurations are still used. I'm not going to go into detail in each of these because we don't have time today, but what I want to mention is just a classical paper written by written by Joe Birdie, entitled 20 Years of Recycle Reactors, and that appeared in this paper here. He also wrote a very nice book, which appeared in the Studies in Surface Science and Catalysis, in which he explains nicely in detail how one can use recycle reactors to study reaction kinetics. Now, let's take a minute here and look at the jet loop reactor design concept. One of the reasons for looking at this particular design, because unlike some of the other reactors that we see here in just a moment, it doesn't involve any like moving parts. When you deal with certain types of gases, which are very corrosive, moving parts can lead to significant maintenance problems, especially.